I kind of had this feeling that I couldn't learn a really proper process in Europe because it isn't here anymore. It's changed. And I wanted to go to Japan because I felt that the Japanese still had a medieval process which was still very hand-orientated, and they weren't relying on grinding machines or mills or anything computerized. It was still very much instilled in the person to have all the skills. And that's what they gave me, really, this really solid technique. When you heat the blade over a long period, you cause the grain structure of the steel to enlarge. And what I do at the end is this cycle to force the grain structure to shrink again. It's called thermal cycling. You take the blade out at about 800 degrees, place it in a cooling solution, only rapidly like I did. If it's too much, you harden the blade. What we want is to cause the shock so that the structure goes smaller and then it goes back again. And you do that a few times, and it causes the grain structure to reduce. And it's a standard thing blacksmiths have been doing since the middle of the 5th century. So now we can go through the de-stressing cycle, which is heating it 3 times, and then we're ready for grinding. My area of interest is the Dark Ages, because there isn't that much known about the what was going on in that time between 500 to 1000. I've done a drawing of the complexity of one of the Anglo-Saxon pattern welded blades. If you imagine, this is a cut through the blade, and this is how it is now with all the pieces all welded together to create this pattern on one side. And this is the same piece exploded. So you can see the parts as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 pieces all assembled to make this. If you look at the knife in a museum, you would never realize the complexity involved. Only until you have x-rays and proper archaeometallurgical research can you understand the absolute brilliance of these people when they were in the Anglo-Saxon period. This is the most difficult technical bladesmithing you can do. Now I have to mark the ricasso. This is a blade I've made for another knife type. But see, you see this line here? This is the ricasso line. And it marks the point of where the blade will taper down to the cutting edge. And it makes a very nice, stylish line here. And you have to be very careful that they start at the same place and they're the same shape on both sides. When you make a sheath for this, when the knife is slipped into the sheath, you need a nice flat area here for the sheath to be able to bind onto. As you pull the knife out of the sheath, there comes a point where the flat area isn't touching the neck and the blade will just slide out very easily. This is very hard to earn a living at knife making. You have to keep at it, keep going to the shows, make a loss in money, make sure that what you're making is of very high quality. And in the end, if you keep doing this, you hope that you'll be noticed, and then you'll become work into becoming full-time knife maker. There are knife makers in Europe who are making a living doing this, and I see no reason why I can't do the same. One of the most important stages of making a good knife is the hardening and tempering process. It's when we make the knife hard so it will hold a good cutting edge. If you look at it now, the blade is now disappearing inside the oven. It means that the blade has come up to about 810 Celsius. And now I'll take it out, hold it, watch it, and then I'll place it in the cooling medium, the oil. And then the blade will be hardened. See, it's an even colour going into the oil now. That nice bubbling noise is a very good sign. If the blade was too hot, it would get a kink. I'll feel it through the tongs and it'd be broken. It hasn't done that. Take it out slowly, and it's gone in straight, come out straight, and we have successfully hardened the blade. Because the crystalline structure is very stressed at this point, and any slight shock it will break, we have a tempering cycle. Then we take the knife, place it in my toaster oven, which runs quite accurately, cycling it three times, and then the blade will have a good grain structure, be ductile, and will hold a very good edge. I've been, myself, as a knife maker, I've been accused of that the hidden tang knife is weak. It won't take any use. That actually a forged blade is not as good as a made blade, which is absolutely rubbish, because all the metallurgical knowledge and research done proves it isn't. And they say that because I don't have pyrometrically controlled ovens and milling machines and vernier calipers, that I can't make things accurately and I can't make them consistently well. Well, I would disagree with that. Spitting on a blade, your saliva, when it hits a blade which is at the right temperature, it balls and just runs around on the surface of the steel. That's what my grandfather told me to do. And he was a rather good smith. What I'll do now is do a test I do on my knives when I make them, to check that the heel, the middle, and the point of the knife is good and strong, ductile, and has strength in it. It hasn't dented or chipped, and I'll test the point. It's very vulnerable usually. It hasn't chipped or broken. And I'll test it for a bang impact. We have a sound blade.